Good afternoon, everybody. I know it's a bit of a reunion, and this is what should happen. This is what is supposed to happen at memorial services. So we do a couple things at memorial services. I think they're built in. By the way, my name is Pastor Sean. I'm here at Hope Chapel. I was fortunate enough to meet Sylvia several times. Got to speak with her and pray with her, and I feel pretty fortunate to have connected. But at a memorial service, there's a couple things that we do, and one, of course, is remember. We remember the loved one, and we celebrate their life. And that in itself is powerful. But secondly, and equally as important, is we reflect. And so we're thinking about what's important in life. I wanted to read a passage of scripture. This is a passage that talks about the life after this life. And it describes what heaven might look like. Now, I can't tell you what heaven looks like, and I'm not sure anyone is perfectly confident of that. But it's going to be better than this. Pretty much can say that. The Apostle John writes this in Revelation chapter 21. He says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. I want to take a moment. Let's open our time together today with prayer. Would you bow your heads with me? Thank you. Lord, in the busyness of our lives and the busyness of our day, even the busyness of getting here, we ask that you would settle our spirits and settle our hearts. And we invite you into our space and this time to speak to us, to encourage us, to build each other up. Thank you, Lord. We give you control today. We thank you for this. In Jesus' wonderful name, amen. So we got something super, super special. Elizabeth is going to sing a song. A lot of times we have someone come and actually lead in a song. One of our people on our worship team, and Elizabeth actually is on our worship team, and she's one of our song leaders. So thank you, Elizabeth.
Like me, I once was alive. first believe, my chains are gone, I've been set free, my God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing. Good to me, His heart, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone. His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be
Thank you, Elizabeth. We're going to take a time where we ask you to say some things. So we're going to have you share if you'd like. And whether it's written down or it's something that a memory that you have that you'd like to share with all of us, it's a way of celebrating Sylvia. And so we're going to start with the family. And I've asked Debbie if she would come first.
Welcome, everybody. I wrote it down because I was afraid I would forget what I was going to say. We're here together to celebrate the life of Alicia Sylvia Bellotta West Essany, or lovingly known as Mom, Nana, Nama, Grandma, Sister, Friend, Aunt, Niece, or Cousin. However she was related to each of us, we had a unique relationship with different memories of Mom. And later you get to share your specific memories with her. I mean, about her. I thought the best way for me to celebrate my mother this day is to highlight her legacy, which is her family. And most of them are here today, or a good part of them. But there's actually five generations in this family, beginning with Mom and on down to her great-great-grandchildren. The last time this family had five generations living was when Mom's mother, Grandma Mickey, was alive. Grandma and her siblings were the first generation. Mom and her siblings were the second. My brothers and I and the children of Mom's siblings are the third. My children and the children of my brothers are the fourth, and two of my grandchildren were the fifth. There's a picture that I brought of the five generations. I guess it's out there in the hall if you want to see it. This was taken in 1999. When Grandma passed away, that brought us back to four generations. Then this year, 2023, 24 years later, both of Mom's great-grandchildren had babies of their own, which brought us back up to five generations. I looked up on Google about the rarity of having five generations, and Google said that four generations are relatively common, but five generations still living is rare, especially when it repeats itself. And to top it off, we all live by, close by, in the same valley. Mom was 89 years old when she passed, although she swore she was only 88. We argued about that several times, and she wanted me to make sure that everybody knew she was 88 and not 89. Either way, she was old enough to make that rarity a reality of the five generations. And most of you here today are part of that legacy statistic. Mom was born on March 3rd, 1934 in New Boston, Ohio. She grew up there, went to Catholic school there until she graduated. She studied dance and she sang beautifully. Mom traveled with band groups on the road for several years before she met and married our dad, Earl West. She met him because he was the owner or manager, I can't remember which, of a nightclub in New York. And she was there to sing. Mom even at one point recorded her own vinyl 78 record. Not sure what happened to the original recording, but my brother Steve said that it was really scratched and not in good condition. Earl and Sylvia got married in 1955 and started having their own children. In fact, they had five of us in 7 years. This is where her legacy begins and continues on from there. Before Mom passed, her family had grown to five generations. In all, Mom personally had five children, 12 grandchildren, 13 great-grandchildren, and two great-great-grandchildren, making a grand total of 32 children and grandchildren. Mom loved it when the new babies were born. She was so cute with them. In the past 6 months of her life, she got to hold her two new great-great-grandchildren. Her face lit up each time as she looked at the new pictures. So when we visited her, she always asked how they were doing and wanted to know all about them. Carrie would share with her the latest photos and videos of them learning new things like sitting up and walking. She couldn't wait to hold them again. So 2 days before Mom passed, we brought them in to see her and took pictures. This made Mom really happy. We had the photos. They're not up here, are they? They're in the back. There's photos in the back. They're not in really good shape because they were just taken with our phones. Because at that point of her life, she couldn't get up. She couldn't even sit up. But if you want to look at them, they're in the back, in the foyer area. Mom also had friends in Pahrumpin here in Lancaster. We have a group that meets at our house that Mom was a part of, and some of them are here today. The members sang songs to her around her bed and prayed with her and loved on her. One of those members, Dr. Gary Grubb, he's sitting right here, came weekly and serenaded her with popular songs from her past. She loved his singing. Gary used to be our family's doctor before he retired and started singing. Mom would light up when he came over to sing to her. When Mom used to sing in her band, One of the songs she would sing was called All of Me. Here's a short video clip of Gary singing that song to her. And I want you to watch how she responds and even sings with him.
All of me. Why not take all of me? Can't you see that I'm no good without you? Take my arms, I want to lose them. Take my lips, I'll never use them. Your goodbye left me with eyes that
sweet. This happened weekly. He came over and he sang to her, and she laid there and listened, and she sang with him, and she would, at times with some of the songs, she would, you know, like she was guiding him, she was leading him, and then she asked a bunch of questions is what she did there at the end. But anyway, that was just one part of her life. We have other friends here too that some of the friends, they gathered around her bed and they'd sing songs to her. And she would answer back and sing with them. Anyway, I lost my spot. And then there's Pastor Sean. Pastor Sean has been our pastor for 20 years. And he was her pastor when she used to live here in the Antelope Valley. And he was her pastor when she came back. I want to tell just a short little story about him with her. The day she passed, he was over. I called him earlier that day and said, I think Mom's ready to go. And he came over to see her. And he reached out. She wasn't awake at that time. Her eyes were closed all the time. And she wasn't responding to anybody. But when he reached out to take her hand, she reached out, she opened her eyes, looked at him, reached out and grabbed his arm as if to say, her eyes got bright, and as if to say, I know you. And so we knew she was still recognizing people. But anyway, I want to thank you, Pastor Sean, for giving her that comfort and peace at the end of her life. That meant a lot. And then certainly, but not least, there's Hank. We all know Hank. The whole family knows Hank. Mom and Hank spent 33 years together. They took care of each other. They shared life together. And a lot of that life was with all of us too. They were always there for each other. They raised many pets together, as they called them, their children. since Hank was such a big part of her life, I just had to talk about some of the things that he and Mom did together. First, there's the Chinese checkers competitions. For many years, they would play the same Chinese checker games every night. It was a ritual, a little bizarre, but a ritual that they did every night. And what was really funny about it is they kept score. They kept score in little black books that they kept for years. And this was to prove who was the best Chinese checkers player. It was funny. It was fun to watch. Mom always bragged about being the best, and she won most of the games, if not all. Then they also had a special time they played in the evening. And then that was when they weren't doing the second thing that they liked to do together, which was sorting the mail. They got stacks of mail. The first thing that happened was they had to decide which one was going to go out and get it. And I have to tell you that at this age, at 66, I understand that a little more. Now, you don't want to go if you don't have to. And so the other person can go, right? As you get older, it's like that. And I remember Mom always saying, just wait till you get to be my age. Anyway, the reason they spent this whole time, and they would spend hours doing this, is because they got stacks of catalogs and magazines that they would go through. Hank would sit at the end of the table, Mom would sit to his right, and they each had their own stack of mail that they sorted through, and they looked at all these catalogs, and they earmarked them, and they circled, and it kind of reminded me of a time as a child. Remember when the old Montgomery Ward magazines came out, and we all, as kids, circled all the toys and earmarked the pages, and then we begged our parents for it, for this specific toy, because if we didn't get it, our lives were ruined. So, you know, it would be so much better if we got these certain toys. And that's what they reminded me of. But it was fun to watch. And then not only catalogs, but things that there were to read, important things that made their lives better or perfect. I remember sitting there and Hank tearing out different articles and wanting us to read, oh, this is important. So we had to read those, which a lot of times it was important. Anyway, also at age, you get, you know, everything's, you gotta read everything that's bigger. Yeah. And still it's hard to read. Anyway, okay, so Hank, though, kept in touch with me almost daily. When Mom came to live with us, his conversations always ended the same way, though. Do you remember Hank? Always asked me to kiss her on the forehead and tell her he loves her. Tell her that he loves her. And that was every time we talked. So, Hank, I want to thank you for all those years of taking care of our mother. When Mom first came, she was having difficulty remembering who certain family members were. So I made a simple chart with her and all her children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and great-great-grandchildren. I put it on the wall in her bedroom, and we repeatedly spoke about it to refresh her memory. Then later, my sister-in-law, Melody, color-coded it to make it more easy to read. That's also out there in that stack. Is it out there? Yeah. If you want to look at that. This helped her to stay informed of who was who and how everybody was related. And lastly, Mom's passing's been hard for me, but I like to think of it this way. Two of my brothers, Steve, Jim, and myself, each had a child, Christina, Holly, and Lisa, who have passed away. I believe that Mom was ushered into heaven by her three grandchildren, and she's happy spending eternity with them, as well as with our Savior and all the relatives and friends that have gone before her. Yes, Mom left a long line of children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, great-great-grandchildren, relatives, and lifelong friends. And all of us are part of her legacy.
So wow, look at this. This might be embarrassing. My wife says, stay on the notes. Okay. All right, so Hank, awesome. Just awesome. We're so glad to have gone out there to visit you guys. Okay. Something happened back in 84 when my son, that's 39 years ago, my oldest son, scared his new mommy real bad. We were over at having a party and a gathering and a family reunion. And Steve, you remember that with the pool? Remember the pool? The Gilmans? And was it you that went off the diving board and got hurt, or was that Jim? Long time. Was it? It was Steve? Anyway, I'd like to see you actually try that again, that flip off the diving board. Yeah. Anyway, the point is, Evan was just a baby, and I don't know if Nama, Melody were upstairs and getting dressed to go swimming or whatever, and laid him on the bed right there, and he just began to roll. So off he went on the bed and scared them to death. But he was okay. Everything was good, and I just thought I'd share that with you. Anyway, we were you? Yeah. Okay, so he rolled off the bed. There were clothes on the floor, so he wasn't hurt. But Mom and Melody were sure shocked, and they laughed about it. Okay, there's so many other memories I could share. Douglas came home from Iraq in mid-tour leave. And then we all went to Vegas to celebrate his 21st birthday. Douglas, you remember that one? Where are you? Remember that one? Yeah. So, yeah. So, after we went to Vegas, we went out to Mom and Hank's and got out there, and they had decorated the house. Remember that, Hank? You guys decorated the house with the banners and streamers and stuff for a welcome home. We're so proud of Evan and Douglas and their service to our country and their patriotism. Mom even took their pictures to Walmart, and they hung them up. That was cool. Walmart had this little thing where they took soldiers and put them all up. It was this great big wall of them, and they were up there. It was kind of neat. The Walmart out in Pahrump. Remember that? Every time we went into Walmart, that was neat. And they did it for a year. So anyway, I'm so thankful. She will live on in our hearts. And here's some other words from Douglas. Today, as we say our final goodbye, let us commit to carrying her memory in our hearts and to living lives that honor her legacy. Maybe we find solace in the precious gift of life. May our shared love for our grandmother bring us together in times of joy and sorrow. So thank you very much. I did it. Awesome.
I'm going to touch on my mom had a sense of humor. Yeah, sometimes outrageous and hugely inappropriate at times. But I want to touch on that a little bit because that's what I'm going to remember about her. Deb was talking about Chinese checkers, and I remember one time she was bragging about being the best Chinese checkers in the world. And after hearing that for 32 years, I asked her, I said, you know, what do you know about China? Or you don't even speak Chinese. And she says, and I just, sure, she just cut. She says, but I can beat Hank. So, and she laughed for a week. And I'm still trying to find out what was funny about that. But again, thanks, Hank. The Chinese checkers, it was, she'll take that to heaven and she'll probably be teaching people up there. She's probably got a handful of marbles. The other thing, Sylvia, mom, she thought it was real funny to tell her stories, but what I liked about their stories is if no one else liked them, she followed up with her digit, her middle finger, which I won't display, but she knew where that was, and I said, that's inappropriate, you can't do it. She says, God gave me that, and I'll use it at his glory or mine. So those are just a couple things that... I'll remember about it. She was hugely entertaining, and when we were young kids, she used to sing to us. I do remember some of those times. And we did enjoy her singing, playing the piano when we were younger. And she tried a little bit when Hank got her a keyboard just a few years back. So there's a lot of good memories we all have, and those are just a few of mine, and others I'll take with me. But thanks again for everybody for being here. I really appreciate it. It's a good memory for her, and she would really appreciate it. So.
Family or friends, come on up.
Wow, this is intimidating. Okay. Just want to share the last few years, I've gotten the blessing, actually, to get to know Nan a little more. Going out and staying with her for a while in Pahrump. And then when she came to live with us for a while, taking care of her, we got really close and we shared a lot of memories together, a lot of laughs, usually at each other. Yeah, usually her making fun of me, actually. But that was, yes, totally with love, and I got to experience that digit. That was funny. Just a couple, I think two, but that's okay. We'll remember everything about her, but I just wanted to say that I had a pleasure of getting to know her towards the end of mine. We didn't spend much time when I was younger, just every once in a while when we got a chance every few years to go out there and see her, but I'm very, very grateful for the last couple years that I got with her.
Hello. Just a quick memory of when Grandma and Grandpa, my mom, my siblings, and my cousin over there, I loved going at Christmas time and just showing up randomly at her house and sing carols. And yeah, dressed up as Santa and the elves and the reindeers, and basically just trick her into thinking that we were carolers, and really we were just surprised visiting her, and it was super fun. And yeah, and then I loved being able to introduce her to my daughter. My husband never got to meet her, but I loved introducing her to my daughter and watch her interact with her and just watch them hold each other's hands and just have a great time. So I'm grateful that I was able to get that part and the picture so that she'll know who her great Nana was.
I'm one of the outlaws, or in-laws. I've had the pleasure of meeting the whole West family, sometimes under these conditions, but other than that, and thank God for Facebook, we get to know each other a little bit and see each other's humor. I'm married to Steve. I've had the honor of getting to know Sylvia and Hank for the past 6 years? 5 years. 5 years? 6 years. And it's been my honor and pleasure to share my love with them and to receive the love that they have had to give me. And that will continue with my routine visits out to Hank to bring him whatever meal it is he wants. His favorite is greens, right? Greens and ham hocks and baby back ribs, and mom could be having the worst time with her belly, Sylvia, and all of a sudden I'd show up with greens and ribs or fish tacos, and I mean, I make them spicy Mexican fish tacos, and she would eat those and love on it. I don't think she had problems after we left, but she would, and baby backs with Sweet Baby Ray's, and I can't go grocery. I was laughing the other day. We made ribs, and I had a bottle of Sweet Baby Ray's barbecue sauce. I never use barbecue sauce, but I always had a jar of, or a squirt bottle of that for when I would bring ribs out to mom's. And then one day, Deb calls me after mom got to Deb's. Deb calls me, and she goes, she keeps saying she wants something to eat, and I says, go order her some ribs. Let her suck on the ribs. And they got some baby backs with some Sweet Baby Ray's. And mom, you sent me pictures of mom sucking on the baby back ribs because she didn't have her teeth anymore. She couldn't eat it, but she was sucking on those ribs. So mom loved her food. She loved her food. And she loved every single one of you. And I enjoyed my time. And thank you for having me into the family. And so, blessings on us all here and the memories of mom. Thank you.
Okay, you're still gonna get to tell Sylvia stories. So in just a few minutes, right now you're gonna watch a video to just remind you of Sylvia's life in pictures. And then I'm gonna share a couple short thoughts about what's important about life. And then we're gonna eat, which is one of those important things about life. So thank you guys for doing that. Thank you for taking the time. You'll tell Sylvia stories as we eat. Enjoy this video. Enjoy some of the music and the pictures and the memories.
Imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. Only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yeah. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Consider all the worlds thy hands made.
That was fantastic. I love to see the family photos. One of the things that we do when we come to a place like this is, of course, what I mentioned before about family reunions. But we also think about our mortality, because this is where we're all going. There's a scripture given by King Solomon. It's in the book of Ecclesiastes. And I remember an old pastor told me this scripture one time. He said, and I was much younger, more than 30 years ago. And I've used this passage many times. It's in Ecclesiastes chapter 7. It's better to go to a house of mourning than to a house of feasting, for the death is destiny of everyone. The living will take this to heart. In other words, he's saying you're going to get more out of going to a memorial service than you would a wedding or a party, because you're going to think about something that's important, and you might even walk away different than when you came in. I'm hoping that happens today. And I want to share a couple of things with you, and I'm not afraid of you. Okay. I just want to share three words, and three words that I think are really important words, three principles in life that I feel like are up there in the top rung. These three words are forgiveness, acceptance, and love. Forgiveness, acceptance, and love. When I think about forgiveness, I think about the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. And they asked him, they said, Lord, teach us to pray. Show us, you know, how we're supposed to, you know, talk to the Father. And Jesus was real simple. He said, pray this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us of our debts as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. It's one of those passages in Scripture. It's one of the aha passages. You're like, really? It says that? And you think, why would God make forgiveness being such a high priority? There's an illustration of that in Jesus' life when religious people brought to Jesus a woman who was caught in adultery. She was doing what was wrong. They caught her. I think it was a setup. I think it was a trap. They threw her on the floor, and they brought Jesus to her and said, what should we do with her? You know, the law says she should be killed because of her crime, her sin. And Jesus leaned over. He just leaned down and started writing in the sand. And we don't know what he wrote. He didn't say what he wrote. Conjecture. People have ideas about what maybe Jesus wrote in the sand. I think my thought it would be that Jesus might have wrote something like, mercy triumphs over judgment. Anyway, Jesus looked up, and he looked at the accusers, and they had rocks ready to stone this woman. And he said this to the crowd. He said, he who was without sin cast the first stone. And the scripture says that they began to walk away, one at a time. The oldest first. Any old guys out there? Old guys, come on, represent. In the back, I see that hand. Because the older you are, the more you recognize our fallibility, right? You recognize we're all kind of messed up. We all need help. Can't pretend, we can't play that we're going to be good enough for God. We know that we're fallible. And the forgiveness that we show is the forgiveness that we get. Jesus said it this way. He said, the measure that you use will be measured to you. Forgiveness. The second word is acceptance. There's a passage in Romans chapter 8. It says this, the spirit you received does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him, we cry, Abba, Father, Papa, Daddy, God. Adoption. You're adopted and accepted by the Father. This part of this idea of acceptance is such a pervasive part of the Bible. It's one of the core teachings of the Bible. Adoption, you're chosen. No accidents in adoption. You were planned for by God. You were thought about. You were valued. You were esteemed. You are his prized possession.